Okay, so good evening, everyone. I would like to thank Medusane and Dr. Raghunandan for arranging this particular session. So without much ado, let's quickly get into the topic. So the topic for today's discussion is macrocytic anemia and overview. So the objectives of this particular session will be, at the end of the session, the learners will be able to enumerate the causes of megaloblastic anemia, describe the morphology of cells in megaloblastic anemia, discuss the etiopathogenesis and clinical features of B12 deficiency anemia, and similarly the etiopathogenesis and clinical features of folate deficiency anemia. So let's revise some basic concepts. So what is megaloblastic anemia? So they are nothing but a group of disorders in which the rate of DNA synthesis is retarded, whereas the RNA synthesis is perfectly normal. So this leads on to an imbalance in the cell growth. So what happens? This imbalance cell growth first affects the rapidly proliferating cells such as bone marrow, gastrointestinal tract, uterine cervix, and so on. So this is basically caused by vitamin B12 and folic acid deficiency, or isolated B12 or folate deficiency. So as we are all aware, this B12 and folate, they are basically needed for the synthesis of thymidine base pairs, which are an essential component in DNA synthesis. So let's get into the pathogenesis of megaloblastic anemia. So what happens? The person can have either B12 or folate or both the deficiencies. So that lead on to retarded DNA synthesis. However, the RNA synthesis is perfectly normal. So because of retarded DNA synthesis, there is a delay in cell division. The cytoplasmic maturation is normal. So because of delayed cell division, what happens? The daughter cells will have more cytoplasm and a deranged nuclear chromatin. So what happens? The cells are all large because of the delay in cell division. So these large cells are called as macrocytes. So what happens? Again, the nucleus doesn't mature. The imbalance between the nuclear and cytoplasmic maturation gets widened over a period of time. So that again causes macrocytes. So because of that, what happens? All those cells, as they are not maturing properly, some cells will die in the bone marrow and the terminal differentiation may not happen. So because of that, what happens? There is an anemia, because the cells, they don't get mature, so they don't come into the peripheral smear. Even if they come, they are all very immature cells. Most of them die in the bone marrow itself. So that causes an anemia. So this anemia we call as macrocytic anemia. So again, because some of the cells are dying inside the marrow, there is an ineffective erythropoiesis. It means the erythropoiesis is not being effective. So what happens? As these cells die in the marrow, there is an elevated indirect bilirubin, which is causing jaundice. So this is basically the pathogenesis of macrocytic anemia. So megaloblastic anemia. So ultimately what happened? There is an impairment in DNA synthesis. So because of that, what happened? The erythropoiesis is ineffective. And not only ineffective, but also it is abnormal, that you call as dyserythropoiesis. So the two key elements in megaloblastic anemia are ineffective erythropoiesis and dyserythropoiesis. Ineffective, the erythropoiesis is not up to the mark, and the cells that are produced are also abnormal, that is dyserythropoiesis. So what are the causes of megaloblastic anemia? So the causes would be, one is vitamin B12 deficiency. So B12 deficiency can be either because of decreased intake, especially in vegetarians, because meat is a major source of vitamin B12, or inadequate diet and impaired absorption. So this is the area which we are going to focus now. So the impaired absorption may be because of an autoimmune disorder called as pernicious anemia, or it can be because of intrinsic factor deficiency. Gastrectomy, because the intrinsic factor is produced by the parietal cells of the stomach. Malabsorption, because the duodenum, the ileum, they all play a role. So in malabsorption, when the small bowel is affected, the person can have a B12 deficiency. ileal resection, because that is the area where the B12 is internalized into the bloodstream. Then we have the fish tapeworm, also called as Diphyllobacterium lotum, the biological name for that. So that will compete with the dietary vitamin B12. So that can cause a B12 deficiency. Similarly, bacterial overgrowth, the bacteria will compete for the vitamin B12. Again, in the blind loop syndrome, where a lot of bacteria will be produced. So these are all the reasons for vitamin B12 deficiency. We can also have folic acid deficiency, which we will see after some time. Or sometimes there can be conditions where the person is unresponsiveness to B12 and folic acid therapy, especially happening with methotrexate treatment. As you're all aware, methotrexate, it actually inhibits the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase, which we will see in a short. So we'll have the case scenario. So we have a 52 years female, known case of type 2 diabetes on oral hypoglycemic drugs. So this gives a clue that probably she is taking metformin. So she developed gradual onset of dyspnea on exertion and EC fatigability, which she is reporting for 6 months. On examination, she has pallor and yellow discoloration of the sclera, which says she has mild jaundice. She also has after stomatitis and the beefy red tongue. So pallor, beefy red tongue. See, as I said, this B12 and folate deficiency will not only affect the bone marrow, it also affects all the rapidly dividing cells. So in the tongue, what happens? It basically causes that loss of papillae in the tongue, which lead on to this glossy appearing beefy red tongue and jaundice. So in addition, we need to definitely know the neurological changes in vitamin B12 deficiency. So the early changes would be poor gait and memory loss. Later on, there will be severe disturbances in the gait, loss of position sense, psychiatric disturbances, which was called as gobalamin madness. Of course, with the injectable vitamin B12, which is available, these days it is rare. Blindness due to optic atrophy. And the typical numbness in vitamin B12 deficiency is called as the glove and stocking neuropathy or glove and stocking numbness, where the person will complain of numbness in the hands and the feet. And also another neurological manifestation which we really need to keep in mind is arterial and venous thrombosis. So this arterial and venous thrombosis happens because of elevated levels of homocysteine, which we will see, leading on to cerebral infarcts. So other than cerebral infarcts, all the other features are all components of subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord. Why so? We will see shortly. So this is a complete blood count of our 52 years old lady. So as you can see this picture, her hemoglobin is low, 4.3 gram per deciliter. Hematocrit is really very low. Total count is high normal. RBC count is very much decreased. See here, see the MCV, which is 117. So kindly remember, MCV more than 100, you call as macrocytic anemia. However, there are many causes of macrocytic anemia, but please keep in mind when the MCV is more than 110, it definitely points to either a B12 or a folate deficiency. So look at the MCH here, it is 40 picograms, which is again elevated. However, the MCHC is normal. Even in some cases, it can be even decreased. Platelets here in this particular scenario is normal. RDW, red cell distribution width. So RDW is elevated. So all these features point towards macrocytic anemia. So we have a provisional diagnosis of macrocytic anemia. So please understand that in the macrocytic anemia due to B12 folate deficiency, MCV, MCH will be elevated, whereas MCHC can be normal or even decreased. So here, as you can see here, there is a derangement in DNA synthesis. So what happens? All the cells will die in the marrow. So apoptosis of the WBC, not only RBC, but also even WBC precursors in the marrow will be there. So this is called as ineffective erythropoiesis. So please understand that the most common presentation in a B12 deficiency will be anemia alone. However, later, it not only affects the RBC precursors, but also affects the WBC and finally the platelet precursor, that is a megakaryocyte as well, leading on to pancytopenia.
So please note here that the most common reason for pancytopenia in India is macrocytic anemia due to B12 and or folate deficiency. Okay, so pancytopenia, the first diagnosis which we should keep in mind is megaloblastic anemia. So coming to the morphology, so when you ask for a peripheral smear, what and all you get? So this is a peripheral smear which we most likely see in a macrocytic anemia. So as you can see here, so the arrowhead here points to the larger cells. And as you're all aware that you have to compare the RBC size, which is around 7 micron, to the nucleus of a small lymphocyte. So here, as you can see here, it is definitely bigger. And these cells are called as macroovalocytes. So macroovalocytes are larger oval-shaped egg-like cells without central pallor. They appear hyperchromic in the sense they're actually not hyperchromic, but because there is no central pallor. See, as you can see this picture, you can see the central pallor here. Here you can see here, the central pallor is there. However, in these macroovalocytes, the central pallor is not there. So it appears to be hyperchromic, but actually it is normochromic. So there is a marked anisopoikilocytosis. Anaso means variation in the size of the cell. Poiklo means variation in the shape of the cell. So there is a marked anisopoikilocytosis. As you can see here, some are very, very large, some are normal, and some cells are looking even like a teardrop. Then, yeah, so this is a cell. This is actually a neutrophil, which has more than 5 lobes. So this is called as hypersegmented neutrophil. So when can we call a neutrophil as a hypersegmented neutrophil? When, if there is even a single neutrophil with more than 6 lobes, as in this particular case, or if there are more than 5% of neutrophils showing more than 5 lobes or 5 lobes. Okay, so you need to count 100 neutrophils, out of which if you have 5 or more neutrophils with 5 lobes also, you can call as a hypersegmented neutrophil. So please understand that even before macroovalocytes appear in the peripheral smear, you get hypersegmented neutrophils in the smear. So whenever you see a hypersegmented neutrophil, that will give us the first clue that probably the person is having a megaloblastic anemia. And again, this arrowhead points to teardrop cells. So because of this dyserythropoiesis and ineffective erythropoiesis, so these cells are called as teardrop cells because they have to navigate through the marrow and enter into the peripheral smear. So they assume the shape of a teardrop. So they are teardrop cells. And this picture, so here, this points to the RBC with the dot-like thing. So this dot is called as Howell-Jolly bodies. Howell-Jolly bodies will be usually seen in a megaloblastic anemia. Other condition where you see Howell-Jolly bodies will be the splenectomy. So they are basically the nuclear remnants. Normally, the nuclear remnants will be removed by the spleen, by this culling and pitting of the spleen. They will be removed. However, in a macrocytic anemia, because of B12 or folate deficiency, because the cells are all this erythropoiesis is there, the cells are all very immature and they enter into the peripheral smear, most of the cells will try to retain the nuclear remnants. So those bodies are called Howell-Jolly bodies. So these are the cells which you see in a peripheral smear. In addition, you see some other interesting cells. See here, this cell, so this is called as a nucleated RBC. So normally in peripheral smear, you don't see any of the nucleated RBCs. So in macrocytic anemia due to B12 folate deficiency, what happens? Because the spleen and liver tend to produce, because of anemia and ineffective erythropoiesis, there is some amount of extramedullary hematopoiesis. So because of extramedullary hematopoiesis, some amount of splenomegaly will be there. So that spleen, when it produces this hematopoiesis, these nucleated RBCs will be seen in the peripheral smear. So whenever we see a nucleated RBC, we need to count to the number of WBC. Normally in megaloblastic anemia, you see around 1 to 10 nucleated RBC per 100 WBCs. Another interesting finding is this thing here. So this is called as Gabbard's ring. So you can see the beautiful ring-like structure within this RBC. So they are nothing but the remnants from the mitotic spindle. So as the chromatin divides, you get mitotic spindle, the figure of eight. So here in this, it is round, or it will be a spindle with eight shape, or any other fragment will be there. So this is actually a remnant from mitotic spindle called as Gabbard's ring. So this is another RBC which shows some bluish basophilic dot-like thing, which is called as basophilic stippling. So basophilic stippling, so these are nothing but the aggregates of ribosomal RNA. And here in this picture, so you can see one particular cell with more of a basophilic tinge. So this is actually a basophilia. The red cells assume, instead of the pinkish color, it assumes a basophilic tinge, which is called as basophilia. So this again suggests dyserythropoiesis or abnormality, irregular erythropoiesis. So these are another other cells which you see in a megaloblastic anemia. So coming to bone marrow examination. So in the bone marrow, as you can see here, the bone marrow will be very cellular. So you get a hypercellular marrow and you have an erythroid hypoplasia. Normally, the myeloid will be the predominant cell in the marrow. However, here what happens, the erythroid will be more. So actually, there is a reversal of myeloid-erythroid ratio because the erythroid precursors tend to predominate. There will be a reversal of myeloid-erythroid ratio will be there. And all these cells will be bigger. See, as you can see here, all these cells with this basophilic tinge. So all these cells are all the erythroid precursors. In the erythroid series, you have early, intermediate, late erythroid precursors. Normally in the marrow, the late precursors will predominate over the early and intermediate forms. Whereas in the megaloblastic anemia, the early precursors will predominate because they are all very abnormal. At that stage itself, they die usually. So here you can see the early and the intermediate erythroid precursors. So these are some late erythroid precursors. So they'll be the predominant cells in the bone marrow. Even the myeloid series, this is actually a metamyelocyte, which is actually very giant, bigger. And when you look into the nucleus, you can see the nuclear chromatin is actually open sieve-like chromatin. So here, all the cells in the nucleus, you can appreciate this open sieve-like chromatin. And also the nuclear cytoplasmic asynchrony. That's why the cells are all very, very bigger cells with the very big nucleus with the open sieve-like chromatin. All those cells are all giant cells. So you also get giant metamyelocytes and band forms. So this will be the bone marrow picture. Erythroid hypoplasia with reversal of myeloid erythroid ratio, and you see megaloblast with the open sieve-like chromatin. Coming to the next test, that will be the reticulocyte count. So whenever you see a case of a macrocytic anemia, so through the complete blood count, then you order for a peripheral smear examination. In the peripheral smear, as we have discussed, we will see macroovulocytes, hypersegmented neutrophils will be there. And you can have all the cells which I have described. You can have teardrop cells. The red cells can have basophilia. You can have Howell-Jolly bodies. Gabbard rings can be there. Basophilic stippling can be there. Even you can have nucleated RBCs. If you have a bone marrow examination, the findings which we have discussed will be there. Then the most important investigation would be a reticulocyte count. So this is actually a normal picture. The reticulocytes will be counted by a staining called as supravital staining. The stains that we commonly use will be brilliant crassyl blue or new methylene blue. And the arrowhead points to the reticulocytes. So just a recap, you're all aware that in the RBC synthesis, you have the pro-erythroblast, then you have the early or a basophilic erythroblast, then you have an intermediate polychromatophilic erythroblast, then you have a late or an orthochromatic erythroblast, then you have a reticulocyte. So in the reticulocyte, some amount of the RNA fragments will be remaining. And this reticulocyte is a cell which enters into the peripheral smear. In the peripheral blood, it will live for one day. And in that day, once it enters into the spleen, these reticulin fragments will be removed by the spleen. Then it becomes the mature erythrocyte. So this reticulocytes can be detected by supravital staining. So this is a test which has got two significance pertaining to megaloblastic anemia. So one is that in a megaloblastic anemia, as we have already discussed, because of this erythropoiesis, all the cells are all dying in the marrow. So even the early precursor, when it enters a basophilic or a polychromatophilic erythroblast itself, the cells are all dead. So definitely it is not going to reach the stage of reticulocyte. The cells that reach the reticulocyte stage will be very, very less. That's why in the reticulocyte count, when you're doing, the reticulocyte count will be really very low in the peripheral blood. Okay, so that is again one clue to the diagnosis of megaloblastic anemia, where the reticulocyte count will be really very low. What is the other significance is that the moment you treat the person with vitamin B12 or folate or both, depending on the etiology, there will be a rapid outpouring of reticulocytes. So you treat the patient with injection vitamin B12 followed by folic acid. You repeat the reticulocyte count on the fifth day or within a week. You see a drastic, dramatic increase in the reticulocyte count, which basically confirms your diagnosis also. In a resource poor setting, you can confirm your diagnosis based on the reticulocyte count. If there is no outpouring of reticulocyte within 5 days or a week of starting B12 therapy, definitely you need to reconsider your diagnosis. Your diagnosis is somewhere wrong. So that is the significance of reticulocytes. So low reticulocyte count will be there in a megaloblastic anemia. So let's quickly look into the vitamin B12 metabolism. As you can see this picture, non-vegetarian diet, fish, crab, cheese, chicken, eggs, and meat, and milk, and almonds. So they are the sources rich in vitamin B12. The dietary requirement is really low, 2 to 3 micrograms per day. And kindly keep one point in mind that vitamin B12 stores will be definitely adequate in our body. So even if there is a deficiency, it will take years to manifest. Whereas folate, if there is no actual stores of folate in our body, so if there is a deficiency, it will happen within months. Okay. So if I always remember like this, so 3 years and 3 months. So deficiency of B12 will take around 3 years, whereas deficiency of folate will take approximately 3 months. So coming to the B12 metabolism, so this is a very famous picture from the textbook of Robbins, which all of you might be aware. So one thing in this particular B12 metabolism is that there are many carriers of vitamin B12 all along the gastrointestinal tract. And whatever carrier protein, which will be synthesized in the proximal part, will be binding with the beta vitamin B12 in the distal part. So what happens? This is a diet. In the diet, the vitamin B12 will be bound to the dietary proteins. So the moment vitamin B12 is ingested, what happens? The salivary amylase will produce a carrier called as a R binder. So this R binder is called as haptocorin. So this haptocorin is produced by the salivary enzymes, and this vitamin B12, when it still it is bound to the diet through the esophagus, it enters into the stomach. In the stomach, what happens by the diet by the gastric action of pepsin? So this pepsin releases this vitamin B12 from the binding protein. And now this vitamin B12 is binding with this haptocorin, which is produced in the saliva. So now this vitamin B12 with the haptocorin complex is entering into the duodenum. So once it enters into the duodenum, once it reaches the second part of the duodenum, what happened where the pancreatic juices are all added up. So these pancreatic juices will remove this vitamin B12 and the haptocorin complex. In the meantime, in the stomach, the parietal cells produce intrinsic factor. So this intrinsic factor will bind with the vitamin B12 in the duodenum or in the jejunum. So here it is actually binding, and this is taken up, and this vitamin B12 with the intrinsic factor is entering into the ileum. And in the ileum, there is a receptor for intrinsic factor in the ileal enterocytes. This receptor is called as tubulin receptor. Through the tubulin receptor, it enters through the portal vein. And this vitamin B12, now it will be taken up in the plasma by the vitamin B12 transporter called as transcopolamine 2. So from there, it is taken to the portal vein and it will be delivered to the areas where vitamin B12 is needed. So the time taken for these entire process is actually less than an hour. So the moment somebody takes vitamin B12, the time required for its availability in the bone marrow will be approximately an hour. Okay, so that is about vitamin B12 deficiency. So vitamin B12 metabolism. So here we need to really understand that in addition to this pathway, there is also a passive diffusion when we give mega doses or high doses of vitamin B12. So that is the reason when there is a deficiency, you give direct intramuscular injections. So when you give mega doses of vitamin B12, it will be absorbed directly. So this is utilized in the therapeutic angle. So here is a point to remember. Please remember the nutritional deficiencies in anemia. It is iron, folate, and vitamin B12. Iron is absorbed in the duodenum, folate in the jejunum, and vitamin B12 is absorbed in the ileum. So etiology of vitamin B12 deficiency, which we have already seen. Another angle to the discussing about the etiology is that, so in the intake, it is low vitamin B12 intake. Coming to the stomach, autoimmune gastritis, also called as pernicious anemia. And pernicious anemia and H. pylori infestation, all the other things. Again, gastrectomy, ileal resection. Coming to the small bowel, malabsorption syndromes in the bowel. And other than that, you can have obstetric causes like oral contraceptive usage, hormone replacement therapy, and pregnancy where the demand is high. And transcopolamin 2, which is actually the carrier protein of vitamin B12 in the plasma when there is a genetic deficiency, and drugs. Also remember Diphyllobacterium latum, also called as fish tapeworm. So what are the functions of this B12 and folate also? So let's just look into this picture to understand the clinical features, ultimately the pathogenesis and the treatment of megaloblastic anemia by seeing this particular picture. See, what is the role of vitamin B12? So vitamin B12, what happens is that it plays a main role in the conversion of homocysteine to methionine. So what happens? It is basically homocysteine, when it gets a methyl group from gopalamine, it becomes methionine. So what happens now, this in that process, because it gave a methyl residue to homocysteine, this methyl gopalamine is converted into gopalamine. So this reaction is aided by the enzyme called methionine synthase. So now what happens? This gopalamine has to be reconverted to methyl gopalamine for the chain of reaction. So again, this methyl residue is supplied by the most important folate derivative, that is N5-methyl-tetrahydrofolate. So this is supplying the methyl group, and now this is converted into tetrahydrofolate. So this is a key ingredient for this thymidine synthesis. So this tetrahydrofolate is converted into N5-N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate, and this is helping in the synthesis of thymidine base pairs by the enzyme thymidylate synthase, where the uridine monophosphate is converted into thymidine monophosphate, which is leading on to DNA synthesis. So what we need to understand in this picture is that when there is a vitamin B12 deficiency, all the folate will be trapped as N5-methyl-tetrahydrofolate. So this is the folate trap. So what happens? We need this tetrahydrofolate for this thymidine synthesis, which is not available because all the folate will be trapped as N5-methyl-tetrahydrofolate in B12 deficiency. However, suppose if we directly give the patient this tetrahydrofolate, the DNA synthesis will happen, isn't it? However, there are other issues with that we will see. So what happens now? So this tetrahydrofolate, this is the most important ingredient for thymidine synthesis. So this, during the process of this thymidine synthesis, it gets converted into dihydrofolate. So this, see, in this process, it gets converted into dihydrofolate. This dihydrofolate has to be again reconverted to tetrahydrofolate. So this is aided by the enzyme called as dihydrofolate reductase. So this is actually the drug methotrexate is antagonizing this particular enzyme. Another very important role of vitamin B12 will be this, where vitamin B12 act as a coenzyme in the conversion of methylmalonyl-CoA to succinyl-CoA. So in the absence of vitamin B12, the conversion of methylmalonyl-CoA to succinyl-CoA will not happen. So there will be accumulation of this methylmalonyl-CoA and also its precursor, that is propionyl-CoA. So what happens? Two things which we have to understand in the biochemical functions is that, suppose when we treat the person with only folic acid, what happens? Of course, the DNA synthesis will happen. So the folate will be taken up in the bone marrow and the thymidine base pairs will be synthesized. And of course, the megaloblastic changes will get reversed. However, what happens? This particular reaction where the conversion of methylmalonyl-CoA to succinyl-CoA needs vitamin B12 will not happen. So because of that, what happened? There is accumulation of methylmalonyl-CoA and also its precursor, propionyl-CoA. So these methylmalonyl-CoA and propionyl-CoA gets deposited in the neural lipids, especially in the dorsolateral column of the spinal cord. So this will lead on to myelin breakdown. And this is called as subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord. So the other names for this particular disorder, which you need to know, because they can ask in this using these names as well. This is also called as subacute combined degeneration of the cord, is also called as Lichtenstein's disease or Putman-Dana syndrome. So that is the reason you're not supposed to treat only with folic acid, because that will precipitate subacute combined degeneration of the cord or Putman-Dana syndrome. So that is the relationship between vitamin B12 and folic acid. So coming to this pernicious anemia, which is also called as autoimmune gastritis. So this is a picture which we saw for the vitamin B12 absorption. So here we have the type 1 antibodies. They are all actually autoantibodies, autoimmune gastritis. So the type 1 antibodies, which are actually IgG antibodies directed against intrinsic factor vitamin B12 complex. The type 2 antibodies are directed against the intrinsic factor receptors called as tubulin receptors. The type 3 antibodies are directed against the alpha and beta subunits of the proton pump in the parietal cells. So this is the picture of this autoimmune gastritis. And here, as you can see here, all these cells are all the goblet cells, which suggest there is an intestinal metaplasia. And as you can see here, the gastric rugosities are all not there. So there is a definite atrophy of the gastric mucosa with some amount of intestinal metaplasia. Sometimes the cells can even look, the nucleus can even look bigger, which is called as a megaloblastic change. These changes can even be seen in the gastric cells as well. And here you can see the intense lymphoplasmocytic infiltrate. And definitely there is no parietal cells in this picture. So this is actually the picture of autoimmune gastritis. However, please remember the role of autoantibodies. In the previous slide, we saw type 1, type 2, and type 3 autoantibodies. Their role is mainly in the diagnostic. However, coming to the pathogenesis of autoimmune gastritis, it is basically the autoreactive T cells, which causes all the destruction. Since it is an autoimmune etiology, like any other autoimmune disorders, definitely most commonly seen in elderly female. And what we need to keep in mind is these people can also have other autoimmune disorders as well. Probably autoimmune thyroiditis, autoimmune adrenalitis, etc. Another most important feature is that, see the word metaplasia. So as we always remember, metaplasia is always a fertile soil for dysplasia, ultimately neoplasia. So with B12 therapy as well, because it is an autoimmune process, B12 therapy in these patients with pernicious anemia will correct only the megaloblastic changes in the marrow and ultimately the anemia. However, because of intestinal metaplasia, people with autoimmune gastritis have a very high risk of gastric adenocarcinomas. And because of the intense lymphoplasmacytic infiltrate, these people have a high risk of maltoma as well, mucosa-associated lymphoid tumors in the gastric stomach. So these patients, again, treatment would be to inject vitamin B12 and monitor reticulocyte count. However, the risk of carcinoma is always there. So pernicious anemia, it has insidious onset of anemia. Moderate to severe megaloblastic anemia will be there. The person will also not only the RBC precursors that are affected, but also the WBC as well as the platelets, so pancytopenia. So leukopenia with hypersegmented neutrophils will be there. These people will have elevated levels of homocysteine and methylmalonic acid. So the diagnosis will be serum antibodies to intrinsic factor. So outpouring of reticulocytes and elevated hematocrit in about 5 days of B12 therapy. So this particular thing is not only for pernicious anemia, but also for any megaloblastic anemia. So this we need to definitely keep in mind. These people have a very high risk of gastric adenocarcinoma and maltoma. So coming to folate deficiency anemia. So you know this tetrahydrofolate, this is the most important precursor, which is actually an intermediate in one carbon metabolism. So in the diet, it is available as polyglutamates. It is very much abundant in the diet. Green leafy vegetables, asparagus, broccoli. So many plant products will have very rich folate. But the thing is that even if you boil or heat the food for 10 minutes or even less than that, it is very heat sensitive. So folic acids will be destroyed. So it is absorbed as a polyglutamate. Once it enters into the alimentary system, the intestinal conjugases split it into monoglutamates. So this folate will be absorbed in the jejunum. So as I already said, iron in the duodenum, folate in the jejunum, and B12 in the ileum. So in the plasma, it is transported as N5-methyl-tetrahydrofolate. So the daily requirement would be 50 micrograms per day, and the deficiency will be within weeks to months. Especially alcoholics with cirrhosis develop deficiency. One is because generally alcoholics will have a generalized malnutrition, and also another very important thing is that alcohol will inhibit with the absorption and the metabolism of folate in the body. So we have completed B12 into folate. So deficiency of folate can be because of decreased intake as seen in alcoholics, impaired absorption, malabsorption, anticonvulsant, again oral contraceptive pills, increased loss in hemodialysis patients, decrement is increased in pregnancy, infants, and cancer, impaired utilization, especially when the person is taking folic acid antagonist. So the last would be, which we have already discussed, unresponsive to B12 folate therapy. So having discussed all this, to the clinician, it is really important you need to distinguish between B12 or folate deficiency. So we have already understood that folic acid will reverse the hematological damage caused by B12 deficiency, whereas neurological changes will not be reversed. Rather, it gets worsened by directly administering folate. So we need to definitely know the clinical and the laboratory differences. So this is very, very important. See, as you can see here, B12, the onset is chronic onset, maybe around 3 years, whereas folate deficiency is acute, happens within weeks to months. Clinical features will be similar. So there can be more of glossitis and GI disturbances in a pernicious anemia also. Whereas in folate deficiency, the clinical features will be mostly similar. Some epithelial damage will be there. So clinical features may not aid us in making a diagnosis of whether it is B12 or folate. Coming to the CBC, you get a macrocytic picture. What I mean is that the MCV, MCH will be elevated, MCHC will be normal. So that is a picture in both B12 and folate deficiency. In the peripheral smear also, whatever cells we discussed will be there. Similarly, bone marrow as well. So when you come to the specific assay, when you do a serum vitamin B12, levels will be decreased. Whereas for folate, you can either do a serum folate or a red cell folate. Red cell folate will be really accurate. So the levels will be decreased. Coming to serum homocysteine levels, definitely elevated in B12. Folate also, it will be elevated. Whereas serum methylmalonate levels, as I said, only vitamin B12 is required for the conversion of methylmalonyl-CoA to succinyl-CoA. So methylmalonate levels will be elevated, whereas folate levels will be normal. So you need to definitely do the specific assays to make the perfect diagnosis. So coming to the management, so for vitamin B12, mega doses of injection B12 can be given intramuscularly, whereas folate can be given orally. So the dose is 1000 micrograms. Here it is 5 milligrams. So you can give 1000 micrograms over 3 weeks, approximately 6 doses. Sorry. And for folate, daily for 4 months, and maintenance. So it is one single injection for every 3 months. So here, depending on the etiology, maybe lifelong therapy may be needed in patients with the inherited hemolytic anemias, hemodialysis patients, etc. Prophylaxis of vitamin B12 will be needed in total gastrectomy and ileal resection, whereas folate prophylaxis is needed definitely in pregnancy, hemolytic anemia, dialysis patients, and also another important category is preterm babies. So in preterm babies, the neural development will be progressive, and definitely in the preterm baby, milk will not have adequate amount of vitamin folate levels. So definitely you need to supplement folate to preterm babies. So that is the management of megaloblastic anemia. So with that, I conclude my session. Thank you all. Any questions we can discuss? Over to Raghunandan.
Yes, ma'am. If anyone have any doubts, you can just post them in the chat box. We will be waiting for 1 minute. If you have any doubts, you can post and ma'am will be clearing them. Thank you, ma'am. I guess there is no doubts. And if anyone have any queries in future, you can just post it in the comments after the session ends so that ma'am will be clearing them in future. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us with us today. So we will do more sessions in the upcoming days, ma'am. Thank you so much. And thank you, viewers.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. And kindly leave your feedbacks, both positive as well as your criticisms, so that we will improve in further sessions. Thank you all.
Ma'am, excuse me, ma'am. There is one question.
Yes.
From which week should we start giving folate for pregnant women?
Yeah, so this is a very nice question. So actually, see, the by the time when they confirm the pregnancy, usually probably around 1.5 months only they confirm the pregnancy. So ideally, folate should be given even if the couple are planning for pregnancy itself. They need to start on folate, or at least the moment the pregnancy is confirmed, they need to take folate. Only folate and not iron, because iron has got some amount of teratogenicity. So iron should be started in the second trimester, whereas folate should ideally be started even before the conception. Folate has to be started.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I guess that's all the queries. If in future, if you have any queries, you can just post in the comments and ma'am will be clearing it in the further session or in the comment box itself. Thank you so much, ma'am. Let's meet us in another session. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.